BBC World Service, I'm Lyse Doucet. Close your eyes, make a wish. For your country. Remember? That's how we started our series, A Wish for Afghanistan. This is our 10th, our final episode. I'm sorry to end our conversations. I hope you'll miss them too. But even more than that, I hope you've taken something from everyone who shared their story. We've listened to politicians, diplomats, activists. And along the way, as we recorded our conversations, we met many other Afghans and asked them, what's your wish for Afghanistan? Many spoke of the very basics of life.
I want my people to be rescued from poverty and hunger, especially the children who are starving.
Some shared their dreams.
I wish the Taliban would allow girls to go to school and attend higher education.
I want the people of Afghanistan to have a chance to have a successful future.
But so many are reeling. It's been a year of overwhelming upheaval in a country already torn by four decades of conflict. So many Afghans have just one big wish, an end to war.
A great peace in Afghanistan. This is my wish for my people.
To have an independent country one day. A country without guns and poverty.
In this program, we'll try to reflect on some of these wishes. We'll also look back at our conversations. Is there still hope in a country haunted by so many missed opportunities? Remember the Persian word which inspired the title for our series, Kashke. To help us make sense of it, I've turned to an old friend, a poet, in a land of poets. Massoud Khalili. It's one small word which conveys so much meaning. Kashke, if only. My wish, if only it had been. Afghanistan is like one kashke after another.
So right, Lyse. Kashke. This is a word that for the last 43 years we use it. Kashke the king was not out.
1973, the first coup.
1973, yes. Kashke, the communists did not take over. Kashke, the Russians did not invade. Kashke, we did not fight. All these kashkes. Now we have to remember these kashkes and don't repeat in a way that we did it.
Massoud Khalili isn't just a poet. He's the son of Afghanistan's greatest 20th century Persian poet, Ustad Khalilullah Khalili. He's also a former ambassador, a former fighter who spent years in the mountains of northern Afghanistan battling against the Soviets. Massoud Khalili has seen opportunities missed, mistakes made. He's lived through most of them, helped make some of them, stood beside those who chose war when they could have chosen another path, which might, just might have led to peace.
74 years old, you've seen so much, been through so much. What are your dreams now?
Nothing but to see peace in my country. You know, in Afghanistan, it's not easy just to sit and, you know, say, okay, let us get united. Because in the wars, we are united. In peace, we are not united. Now we should bring a situation to create a leadership, to talk to our enemy and say, okay, let us bring maybe a broad-based government or, you know, inclusive government. First, you include those who are indeed having a desire and a kashke to help their country. There are different ethnic groups, Pashtuns, Tajiks, Hazaras, Nuristanis, and all others. They all should live, as in many countries they live in groups. Let us go together, make our nationalities a nation.
I've known Massoud Khalili since the late 1980s. We first met in the Pakistani frontier city of Peshawar, home to many of the men known as the Mujahideen, the Islamic fighters. They'd cross back and forth into Afghanistan, fired by a passion to defeat the Russians occupying their country. Massoud Khalili always carried notebooks in his hands, poetry in his heart, his head, often reciting.
Nalab dil shud gire, rah neistan kujast, khana qafas shud baman, tarfi biyaban kujast. That is of my father. It's a beautiful ghazal, saying that, where is the beautiful days I had? Where is the song of the flute that I heard? Where is that? But I hope that the country will have its beauty again. Whenever in the mornings I wake up, I pray sometime and I read poetry. Then I read politics and watch BBC. And then, with the poetry, it gives my heart some kind of power. With BBC, I just get surprised. Oh my goodness, again, war is going on there.
The guns have gone silent across much of Afghanistan. But it's not peace. There's still violence and killings, much of it blamed on the Taliban. Still savage suicide attacks by extremist groups like Islamic State. And for many Afghans, this isn't the future they, their children, had hoped for, worked for over the last two decades since the US-led invasion in 2001, triggered by the September 11th attacks on New York and Washington. For Massoud Khalili, his day of destiny came 2 days earlier. It involved his close friend, comrade in arms, fellow lover of poetry. The legendary Mujahid who fought the Soviets, was embroiled in the bloody civil war, then fought the Taliban. Ahmed Shah Massoud, a man Massoud Khalili calls the commander.
September the 8th of 2001. Tell me about that evening in northern Afghanistan.
Still, it is painful. Taliban were in Kabul and all over Afghanistan. Commander called me and said that, come. And so that night in that small room, we talked about politics, about Al-Qaeda. And he was saying that so many Al-Qaeda people, you know, are around Afghanistan. And then there was a book of Hafiz.
The great Persian poet.
Absolutely. And you know it, that Hafiz is very famous. Everybody, you know, in every house, poor or rich, they love Hafiz, you know. And, you know, a kind of tradition we have that we open it and whatever comes, we say, well, that is the future. Especially young girls, young boys, when they are in love, then they get Hafiz and open it and say, well, she will be loving me or not. Then he told me, let us open it and see what happens. And I opened it and a beautiful piece of poetry showed up. I started reading for him. شب صحبت غنیمت دان که بعد از روزگار ما nights pass, days go, and years will disappear. You two will not be able to see each other again. Plant the seed of love in your heart. He said, oh my goodness, what? And I was, of course, also, what? At least for 2 minutes, looking at each other. Like scenes in a theater being played by two who do not know what will happen.
At that time, Ahmed Shah Massoud posed the main military challenge to the Taliban. His stronghold in the Panjshir Valley in northeastern Afghanistan was one of the few places the Taliban still didn't control, even after 5 years in power. The Soviets never managed to capture it either. The next morning, Ahmed Shah Massoud headed to an interview with two Arab journalists. First, he knocked on Massoud Khalili's door.
And then Commander came in. And my passport was also on the bed with a cover of leather. Keep this in mind. And then he came. He said, take this passport. And he put it on my pocket, on the left one. And I said, no, leave it there. He said, no, you keep it here. It is useful.
And then to the interview.
The first question was, tell us the situation. And I was just murmuring in the ear of Commander, bomb. And a big sound. And a thick blue, dark blue fire was coming from somewhere. And then I felt a hand of Commander on my chest, and I did not remember anything, but others were remembering that I was talking loudly.
Very reliable sources in Central Asia are telling me that Ahmad Shah Massoud died in the first 5 minutes of the attack. We know that there were two...
Massoud Khalili woke 5 days later in a hospital bed in Germany. Unlike his friend, he'd survived, losing the sight of one eye, the hearing in one ear, his body peppered with hundreds of sharp pieces of shrapnel.
My wife told me that, look, this is your passport. Can you believe it? In the passport, about 8 shrapnels were stuck, not touching my heart.
It saved you.
Saved me because it was leather cover, and the shrapnels just reached that and stuck. And I said, oh my goodness, I wish I could put that passport on his pocket, because my people need not Massoud Khalili, they need Ahmad Shah Massoud.
What if Ahmad Shah Massoud had survived that day? Some say this attack was a signal to Al-Qaeda's suicide bombers that it was time to strike in New York and Washington. Would history have still unfolded as it did? Afghan history is riddled with what-ifs. Some were highlighted in our series. At the very start, there was the Taliban letter of December 2001, handed to the new leader, Hamid Karzai, offering to recognize his rule in return for being allowed to go back to their villages. What if he'd made more of it? Another possible misstep, excluding the Taliban from the international conference in Germany to choose a new leader in 2001. Remember what the negotiator Fatima Gailani said?
How could we even think that we will have peace if we don't have part of the war with us to sit down? They are not piece of ice that we will put in the heat of the sun and hope that they will disappear. They are Afghans and they will never disappear.
But the raw, bitter taste of war prevailed. Massoud Khalili remembers that.
It was a victors' conference. Was that a mistake?
To not including Taliban, yes. If you don't have vision, you're perished. And we missed that chance. Maybe I was one of them also that don't allow Taliban. That was a mistake. It was emotions from the shrapnels, not wisdom from my mind.
For many, it marked a new start, but not for all. In our second episode, Abdulsalam Zaif, who helped found the Taliban, recalled how he warned the US, "You'll be defeated and we will return." He was proven right. And we also heard a voice from a village like so many others, which bore the brunt of the war. Dr. Roshanak Wardak was furious about another foreign occupation, this time by America. What about our poet Massoud Khalili, who resisted the Soviet troop presence?
Personally, I was hoping a lot out of this. After 9/11, I said, okay, now Afghanistan is not abandoned and it's a chance because it's a common goal. A new war, a common goal against terrorism. And that was a hope for me. And I was telling my friends, take advantage of the time. Because here we have got not just America, but the NATO forces and Muslim countries and the world and United Nations. My worry was that they are fighting in Afghanistan against smoke, not against fire. The fire is lying in Pakistan.
You thought that because of Pakistan's support for the Taliban, their sanctuary, their training, etc., that's always a source of argument. Pakistan denies it, but so many in Afghanistan believe that that's the real strength behind the Taliban.
They cannot hide it. We cannot hide it. Pakistan had its own strategy. Never allow Kabul and Kashmir to be not under their influence. Americans and NATO forces fought in Afghanistan, but you have swept them to Pakistan, not swallowed them.
Was there a moment in the last two decades when you started losing hope that this could be a good chapter for Afghanistan?
Despite I was trying to not lose my hope, but always telling my friends that still we should fasten our seatbelt. This is not the end of the game. No, This is Afghanistan, the country that its geography is making its history.
All of Afghanistan's neighbors had their own interests, their own proxies. But Afghans themselves have to take responsibility.
Well, you are very right. I am not blaming others and forgetting myself. Every morning what I do, Lise, I get a mirror and see my face first, and then see the faces of others. We Afghans should have had one thing always, which we did not have it, vision. If I win the war, what happens? We, because of our own self-interests, or because of ethnicity, or because of religious things, or whatever in Afghanistan, we have not been able to create a trusted leadership in the country to be listened by the people. We have to now think not just twice, 10 times, to not repeat what we did wrong. But we Afghans still have time. This is why I have hope. If I don't have hope, at least I die every minute. If I have hope, I live forever. Really, I believe in that.
For many, the biggest issue was the absence of honest, accountable government. That's something Massoud Khalili's generation, the political leaders, the powerful commanders known as warlords, failed, hopelessly failed, to bring.
Many said that their corruption, their nepotism, was an even bigger threat to Afghanistan than the Taliban, the rising Taliban insurgency.
I agree with them. We were not united, disunited. Billions came to Afghanistan. What we did in that situation was really wrong. And the government of Ghani was not just corrupt, didn't have at all a vision.
Corruption. That could have played a part in the collapse of the Afghan National Army. The US, other NATO militaries, poured vast sums of money into creating it. The former leader, Hamid Karzai, told me in December 2001, a national army was his first priority. So why did the Taliban then sweep into Kabul, almost without a fight? In our last episode, Mateen Beck, former chief of staff to President Ashraf Ghani, put it down to a failure of leadership in the government he was part of.
That government failed big time. Former President Ghani, I think the whole thing was based on lie, deception, because no one was getting the enough support they needed to fight back. There was provinces, district, which was sieged for weeks, for months, and we could have supported. We didn't.
A belated mea culpa from a player in meetings which mattered in those last fateful weeks.
The main news tonight, the Taliban have entered the Afghan capital Kabul after the President Ashraf Ghani fled the country, insisting he wanted to...
What were your thoughts that day?
Well, a catastrophe. Painful. Is this the result of 20 years of hoping, dreaming, thinking, going to my garden, going to the beautiful streets of my city, my beloved city, which I was born in, and all my friends?
The Taliban say they have brought peace to Afghanistan. And in fact, many people tell us from the villages that the US-led warplanes are out of the skies, the night raids have stopped, Taliban attacks have stopped.
Well, I also, after some weeks or days, thinking that Taliban would be just the same as they were, not allowing the kids to fly kites, the girls to go to school, the women to wear even high heel shoes. Should we just allow them to do it or go for another war? But I heard my father's voice telling me that we have to wait and see, step by step. And for the time being, okay, fighting is stopped because they were the source of the fighting and killing of the people. They were sending with pride suicide bombers that kill people. Let us see what they do. do they make Afghanistan security as in graveyard? If like graveyard, we should not accept that. If not as a graveyard, encourage them to do right things.
And what do Afghans want?
My name is Mohammed. I'm a student, and my wish to leave Afghanistan, if not to find work, to find money for food to eat.
My wish from Islamic Comrade to prepare the working for the young generation. Most of them, they are jobless. The young generation is our biggest energy. They must stay here and they must work for their homeland.
My name is Satoresh. I'm 11 and I dream of becoming a doctor so I can serve my country and cure the sick.
Dreams for a different country. When I first came to Afghanistan in 1988, in a harsh winter, in the dying days of the Cold War, as Soviet troops were preparing to pull out, even then Afghans kept asking me, is it going to get better now?
Not a day goes by without someone asking me, when are you going to leave Afghanistan? Isn't it going to get very dangerous? I'm not quite sure what I'll do. I've become very attached to the country and to the people, and I feel a certain amount of responsibility.
Here we are, 33 years on. I'm still going back and forth to Afghanistan. Another harsh winter looms, Afghans asking the same hard questions. Now second-hand goods are stacked along the streets, sold by families fleeing their country, sold simply for money to survive. Even stories now of fathers and mothers forced to sell their children. Their children. A country on a countdown to a humanitarian catastrophe. That's how the UN describes Afghanistan now.
Massoud Khalili, we've spoken at so many turning points in Afghan history. But I have to say that this seems to be one of the darkest. There are, of course, Afghans who support the Taliban, but so many Afghans, especially young Afghans, feel they've lost everything, including their country.
They're right.
Have you lost your country?
No, not lost. Even if they're refugees, they will not be lost. I was a refugee. I didn't lose my country. They're angry. They're disappointed. They're hopeless to a large extent. When they leave Afghanistan, and they do not know where they go. Maybe they will be happy, okay, in the West. But the land has not lost. A country is the people. Yesterday, there was a demonstration by girls. This movement that is started, civil movement, may give a chance to people to win war and peace.
We do see these demonstrations, smaller and smaller numbers. We see often Taliban fighters moving against them, sometimes arresting people. Do you think it can be called a movement?
Yeah, everything starts from zero. We have a phrase that drop by drop, you can make an ocean, rock by rock, a mountain.
Katra katra darya mesha.
Absolutely. Even those who are escaping, they are not escaping to forget it. They are escaping to stand somewhere else against Taliban with their iPhone. The United Nations is concentrating. NATO countries concentrating. They are with us, will be with us. And above all, I believe in God. I think he will be with us too, probably.
You lost the sight in one eye in the Al-Qaeda attack of 2001. Your other eye was damaged when you were near to another suicide bombing by the Taliban in 2017. When we speak, I think of all that shrapnel still in your body. You carry the war in you, like every Afghan.
I wish, Kashki, that I was carrying not the war, but peace. Heart, heart, heart. یار ز چرخ بستگی ها دارم در سینه ز داغ خستگی ها دارم I have so many knots in my life so many links in the chains. But I want one day that break it, and you be with me, and we love each other. That is the Koshki. Oh my goodness.
What if, even some Taliban leaders admit, it would have been better to have had a negotiated transfer of power? Perhaps fewer Afghans would have fled in panic. Perhaps more aid for Afghanistan would now be flowing in. Perhaps. I still struggle, to be honest, with the enormity of what's happened. Still worry even more may be lost. Any pain is, of course, most profound for Afghans themselves, those at home and those driven abroad.
Your own beautiful house in Kabul with the meditation room, with all of your Persian poetry books, your wife Soheila's calligraphy on the walls. The Taliban are guarding your house now. Can you go back to your house?
Definitely I'll go back to my house one day. The communists took it, then Taliban took it. They have locked it, and they may put some people to sit there, but I will go. We will see that. Koshki. Koshki.
So many people have made our series possible. Our terrific producers, Ed Butler, Luis Hidalgo, Tim Mansell. And for the first two episodes, Neil Rizel. Our great editor, Penny Murphy. Commissioning editor, Steve Titherington, believed in this series from its very start. So did editor Hugh Levinson. Our son Fahim composed our wonderful music. We also spoke to him in episode 8. Music producer Liza Thompson helped guide him and us through this process. We also consulted the great British Ustad of Afghan music, John Bailey. A huge thank you to BBC colleagues in Kabul who've supported us over many years. A special thank you for the advice of old BBC friends, Mahfouz Zubaydi and Shuaib Sharafi. They helped shape our series. We also consulted our former BBC colleague, Kate Clark. Finally, our studio managers, James Beard and Tom Brignall. Their technical wizardry helped create the sound and feel of our programs. And thank you for listening to A Wish for Afghanistan with me, Lyse Doucet. Make a wish for you, your country, and may your wish come true.